going out on this very crisp evening. Somebody informed me that's the word to use. It's crisp. But as I said to someone, you know, what is warmer for the soul than poetry? So aren't we lucky to all be here together? As you know, we owe a debt of gratitude to many people and entities for this evening's event. And so I'll run through the list quickly, but reverently. Our statewide underwriters are the Alma Gibbs Donchin Foundation, the Vermont Department of Libraries, near and dear to my heart, and the Wyndham Foundation, also very near and dear to my heart. Our library sponsors are Against the Grain, Brattleboro Auto Body and Detailing, the Brattleboro Food Co-op, Brattleboro Savings and Loan, and Park Place Financial Advisors, New Chapter, the Richards Group, Wyndham World Affairs Council, and of course, your friends and mine, the friends of the Brooks Memorial Library. We have many other exciting things happening this month, including an artist talk and Q&A with the photographer of these incredible nature photographs that are around the wall, which is great. So please do come back and join us for that. And then just a heads up for next first Wednesday, which will be April 3rd, and it will be Reeve Lindberg talking about her book, Two Lives. And shortly after that, we will have the second annual Friends Just Desserts Party. And those who came last year will remember how much fun it was, and of course, all funds raised go to events such as tonight's. And you guys know about the response forms. And look, I printed a landscape just to give you a little difference. So I know this will make you eager to fill them out. And they are at all three of those tables. So we appreciate any feedback that you give us. And now it is my pleasure to introduce my partner in all of this. She's been so steadfast this season, Carol Gaddis.
Huck Gutman is a professor of English emeritus at the University of Vermont, where he taught courses in 19th and 20th century American poetry and in modern poetry and translation. A former chair of the English department, he has twice taught abroad as a Fulbright Fellow. He has written or edited 4 books and has been a regular political columnist for major newspapers abroad. He also spent 6 years in Washington serving as chief of staff to Vermont Senator Bernie Sanders. He mails to a poetry list and would be glad to tell you how to sign up for these mailings, which come out between once a month and once every few months. It's my honor to introduce Huck Gutman.
Thank you, Carol, and that's that kind of lead in. First of all, did anybody not get a handout? Okay, so everybody has Wordsworth in front of them, right? So that I can't pull any fast ones and pretend there are things in the poems that you can't check me out. I'm gonna pass around a list, which is an email sign-up list, because I do send out these poems. I have the second largest list in the United States, as far as I can tell, for sending out poems, so almost 3,000 people. And I write about poems. I have one ready to send out in the next day or two. So by signing up, you'll get them. And if you want to delist yourself at any time, you can unsubscribe. And I won't give the emails to anybody. They're only for me.
They're very worthwhile.
Thank you.
What a great idea to have conversations about poetry like that.
Well, I'll tell you about that. First, I want to say how happy I am to be here. I'm glad all of you came out. It is unseasonably cold. There is some kind of wiggle in the polar vortex, and it's pouring cold down here. This is March, you know. It's supposed to be occasionally clement. But so I'm very glad you're here. And I have given a number of these talks. I'm a huge admirer of libraries. You're all in the library, obviously. They're the ultimate, I know this is a very, very bad term now, but they're the ultimate socialist institution, right? You take what you want, when you want it, and all you gotta do is bring it back when you're done with it. for books. And for those of you who don't know, you can also get books electronically and read them on tablets, because all the libraries in Vermont get together and do such things. And for those of you who don't go to the library as often as I go to the one in Burlington, the modern library has turned out to be really important for people who don't have computers at home or don't have computer access. Libraries have computers, and they become a really major way for people to interact with people all over the place. About my poetry list, and then I'll get into Wordsworth. I work for Bernie Sanders in Washington, and you would be surprised, or maybe you wouldn't be surprised, at what goes on in meetings of Senate committees. Everybody is a policy expert, everybody knows about stuff. And I really thought people weren't very connected to life itself, whatever that is. You can go to graduate school and study policy and be an expert. So I was on the education committee, working for Bernie for a couple of years, and only one or two people in the whole room had ever been a teacher, right? They all were experts in education, but they never taught any of it. And I would occasionally pull out, everybody in those days had a BlackBerry, I'd pull out my BlackBerry and I'd read them a poem, often by Wordsworth, which is partly why I'm going to talk about him tonight, and say, you got to listen to this. Education isn't just about reading and arithmetic, it's also about joy and openness. And Wordsworth understood that, but you guys don't. And I was nicer than that. But I ultimately started sending out poems to my colleagues. By then I was chief of staff, because I thought they weren't really in touch with the life that goes on in America. There is a kind of bubble-like atmosphere on Capitol Hill. It's not all bad, but people, you know, they talk to each other and they think about politics and they're into this and that. And poems speak to something else in us, and we'll see some of that tonight. So I started sending out emails to my colleagues, and then I started sending to former students I added to the list, and then I added other people, and now, as I said, I have about 3,000 people. And I send out a poem, and I write about the poem, because I think poems are meant for people to read, but they're not always easy of access. Not everything in life comes as easily as we would like it to come. So that's by way of prologue. I'm going to talk about Wordsworth, and it's very nice of you all to come, because when I was 16 in high school, I hated Wordsworth, and I got to college, and I hated Wordsworth. I mean, I really hated Wordsworth. Kind of dull, unmagical lines. I like mountains. And I didn't realize it. It took me a while. And I learned in college, I read a very long poem of his called The Preened, which I really love a lot. And I've revisited Wordsworth from time to time over the years. I realized that Wordsworth is probably the most important poet to write in English in the last 300 years, maybe the most important poet to write in the world in the last 300 years. And there are a lot of really good poets, but there's something about Wordsworth. He was lucky in a way. The poems we're going to read today are all written in the period around 1797 to 1802, right? And something was happening then. To be a really great poet, you have to live in a great time. And what was happening is he was in England, and England was industrializing. So there was the Industrial Revolution and the growth of the modern city, and as if that wasn't enough, in France, there was this enormous revolution which followed ours, but ours wasn't as important. Ours was against a colonial power, and France actually overthrew the government. So there were revolutionary times, and there was a whole new way of living in the world, which had to do with industrial manufacture, and also with people being able to buy things that they couldn't buy before. And Wordsworth lived when the world was in transition, and he was in some way attuned to that. And that's what I'm going to talk about today. And I'm going to go into Wordsworth a little, I think, kind of backwardly, although if this were a college class, which it is not, you think, oh, there's the professor trying to impress us. I'm going to talk a little, I've got to find my clicker. Oh, here it is. I'm going to talk about a German philosopher. When I was in college, I was talking I have some friends here who I should acknowledge at the beginning, Tom Regal and Nancy Regal. Tom and I taught together at UVM, and I have cousins in the back there, John and Jane, who are very kind to have come. When I was in college, and even through the years, early years when I taught at UVM, Wordsworth was always paired with Samuel Taylor Coleridge, because they brought a book out, which I'm going to talk a lot about, called Lyrical Ballads in 1798. They were co-authors, they were very good friends, and Coleridge was a post-Kantian. He was a transcendentalist. He believed in all sorts of philosophical things about ideas, and I always assumed that Wordsworth believed in the same things, and Wordsworth didn't. Wordsworth understood something very different about people, and some of what he got from this very strange man named John Gottfried von Herder. Now, if I were a show-off, I would say I'd read a lot of Herder, but he wrote 30 or 40 volumes, and they're all in German, and when translated into English, I get lost. So I read actually about Herder in a great historian of ideas named Sir Isaac of Berlin wrote about him, and so most of what I'm going to tell you is Herder through Berlin, through me. Herder did three things in his philosophy. He wrote philosophy, he wrote history, he wrote about music extensively. He was part of what Isaiah Berlin calls the counter-enlightenment. Right? The enlightenment is when people are enlightened, and it's also called the age of reason, when everything was subjected to reason, the 18th century. But our Declaration of Independence is a product of that. And it was a great time, and I'm very much impressed by the age of reason. But there were people who thought, well, maybe reason can't do it all. And so there were people who started rebelling against the age of reason, and one of the chief among them was this guy, Herder. There's a picture of him or a portrait of him. And I want to tell you three things about Herder. I promise this won't be long. One, he talked about the importance of das Volk, which is German for the people. He thought culture resided in people, not in famous artists. It was immensely significant. After Herder, people started collecting folk tales. So the brothers Grimm, who were great philologists, grew right out of Herder. If any of you listen to folk music, right out of Herder. I mean, he's the guy who said that's what art is. It comes out of natural effusions from people, from the culture. Not individual people, but from the culture itself. And because of that, he said ballads were really important, and so his very good friend, although they had a falling out, named Goethe, who was the greatest German poet of the time, started writing ballads, and the poems we'll read, and I'll get to this, are mostly, or some of them are in ballad form by Wordsworth. So this emphasis on the Volk, this is not a proto-Nazi, you know. This is somebody who said, no, it's the people that create culture. It's not some guy sitting up in a study writing in a book. Now, they have importance, and I'm going to talk about Wordsworth, who wrote in a book, but he talked about the Volk. He talked about feelings, right? Because we not only have thoughts, we have feelings. And Herder thought that our feelings were really important, and Wordsworth is going to take that up, that when we think, we think as feeling human beings, and when we have to trust to something, maybe we're better off trusting to our feelings than our thoughts. You can see how he's going against the age of reason and all these great ideas about reason. And then he also talked a lot about language, which is not important for us, but is very interesting to me. He thought that everything we do is done through language, and almost all linguistics in the 20th century understands that we think through language, and goes back to Herder and this idea of language being the kind of not only crucible of thought, but the way in which we think in words and in images that are structured like languages. So we're going to leave Herder behind. We're going to go to Wordsworth. Wordsworth grew up in the north of England in what's called the Lake District. As a child, he went to a local grammar school, and he loved to as country kids do, love to be out in the lakes and the fields, and you know, grew up that way. And he went off to university, went to Cambridge, and he was a pretty mediocre student. So there's hope for people who are mediocre students, right? And he wanted to be a poet, but he didn't quite know how. And he went on walking tours, and he met Coleridge, and then one winter he went to put together some poems and lived in a place called Goslar in Germany, and he was cold and miserable, and the heat didn't work. I mean, that was a problem all his life. The heat never worked in his houses. And yet, in 1798, he and Coleridge published this slim book of verses called Lyrical Ballads. And I already told you about how important a ballad was to Goethe. And a ballad is a folk song, right? And it has a very simple rhythm. I'll talk poetry for a minute. It's alternate lines of 8 and 6 syllables, rhyming A, B, A, B. Almost all hymns are in that meter. It's called hymn meter. It's called common meter. It's also called ballad meter. And we'll run into it in this first poem. So Wordsworth decided to write in the style of ballads. And we're going to start with a poem which I find absolutely astonishing. And when I was in college, I thought it just sucked. I thought, oh my God. It's a poem about a guy who goes out walking and he meets a kid and he says, how many people in your family? And she says, 7 of us children. And he says, you know, where are they? Well, 2 are overseas and 2 live in this town here and 2 are in the graveyard and here's me. And he says, well, you know, this is an arithmetic poem, right? Yeah. 2 are dead and 5 are living, so you're 5. She says, no, we're 7. That's the whole poem, right? It's arithmetic. And it's about a clash of 2 worlds, of the poet's world and this child's world. So I'm going to read you the poem, and I'm going to ask you, in a way, to ignore the first stanza. There's Wordsworth when he was younger. As he grew older, he had a harder time writing poems, and he had earned a living, and he got more conservative, and he was not a really good poet anymore. He's mostly a good poet when he was young and uncertain about the world. So here is, and in fact, he says, I put this in here, might as well talk about it. He says in a poem about wandering around, wondering what, you know, what he should do. He wants to be a poet. He runs into an old leech gatherer. I don't understand the poem, although I love it a lot. Who he just is just steadfast in doing what he has to do. But he, in the poem, Wordsworth said, and I think he is in some ways right, and I think he understood something about his own life. I just sent out a mailing about a poem about a French poet named Arthur Rimbaud. For those of you who have Rimbaud, he finished writing poetry when he was 18 years old. That was like all behind him. And then he, you know, lived an unhappy life after that, actually. But, so Wordsworth says in that poem, Wordsworth says something very beautiful. He says, we poets in our youth begin in gladness, but thereof come in the end desperation and madness. And he's going to want to capture that gladness, but he understands that we live desperate lives. Those of you who are Americanists know that that's one of the great lines in Walden by Thoreau. We go from our desperate lives in the city to our desperate lives in the country. The mass of men lead lives of quiet desperation, he says. And he's saying, how can we not be desperate? He's going to go live, build a house in the natural world with his own hands, be self-reliant. It's right out of Wordsworth. I mean, they couldn't have done it without Wordsworth. So let's start with this. I went through all this before, but let's start with something that I want you to recognize. Can't walk over here, oh my gosh. I want you to recognize this because it goes by you so fast that you don't even see. He says 3 different times in the preface to Lyrical Ballads. This was written in 1802, it's to the second edition. He says, the principal object then which I, and he's kind of, in the preface, he's kind of saying, look, this is what I did, you guys should like it. Right, it's a self-advertisement, but it's also his aesthetics. It's his sense of what is beautiful in poetry, and it's—I think—it's the most astonishing thing than anybody ever wrote about poems. He says, the principal object then which I proposed to myself in these poems was to choose incidents and situations from common life. What? We're not going to write about those great moments of love. We're going to write about everyday life. And even more important, he said, and to relate or describe them throughout as far as possible in a selection of language really used by men. I've proposed to myself to imitate and as far as is possible to adopt the very language of men. I ask, what is meant by the word poet? What is a poet? To whom does he address himself? And in what language is to be expected of him? He is a man speaking to men. Wordsworth is making a choice here, and he will in this poem we're about to read, to write in the vernacular, in the language that people use every day. That's not what you think most poets do. That's not what poets of the 18th century did. They used spectacular language to describe spectacular things. This is a rebellion against the poetry of Pope. Have any of you read Pope?
Yeah.
Did you like Pope?
Yeah.
No.
Somebody over there did. I reread Pope a couple of years ago. He's spectacular. He's so good. There are all these rhyme couplets, one line rhymes with the next line. We think that's an old-fashioned thing, right? Well, that's a 20th century poet's beside couplets, other way to do it, just not to be end-stopped. You know, at the end of every two lines, you have a kind of period that you haven't run on. But Pope wrote beautiful, beautiful language, and Wordsworth said, no, I want to write in language that people use in the gas station. That's a really, really major commitment. Out of that will grow, I think, the poetry of Walt Whitman and William Carlos Williams and Guillaume Apollinaire and Pablo Neruda. I mean, all over the world. And not only the Western world, I've mentioned Western poets. There are people who say, no, the people I want to speak to are the people in my community and I want to speak their language. So one thing, the reason I'm starting with this is because I want you to notice in this poem, We Are Seven, that it's all written in very, very, very simple language. Okay, so here's We Are Seven. And it's this poem I told you. The guy says, how many kids in the family? She says, seven. He said, but you're only five to her dead. And that's the poem. And I want you to kind of ignore the first stanza, which I'll read, because it tells you why this is an important poem. Kids don't understand death, which is true. But he's telling us here, and he's showing us in the poem, and showing is always, 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 writers know, showing is better than telling. We show somebody something instead of telling them. So let me just read you the poem. It'll go by pretty quick. I'm clicking by mistake. And you'll see they're talking. It's a colloquy. These two people are talking to each other, and they're talking across purposes. A simple child that lightly draws its breath and feels its life in every limb, what should it know of death? Right? We got, in the next stanza, you'll see it, we got the ballad meter going, right? Ba-dum, 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 ba-dum. Four and three stresses in the line, eight and six stresses, syllables in the alternating lines, and rhyming A, B, A, B, child. Well, it's not in the first one. Let's look at the second. Girl, curl, head, right? Mm-hmm. Okay, that's the A, B, A, B. So, and it starts kind of in media res, in the middle of things. And I'm skipping the first stanza. I'm not going to read it to you. A simple child that lightly draws his breath and feels his life in every limb, what should it know of death? That's the summary. That's for people who are interested in serious poems. Now comes, I went out and talked, met this young girl, right? I met a little cottage girl, she was 8 years old, she said. Her hair was thick with many a curl that clustered round her head. She had a rustic woodland air, and she was wildly clad. Her eyes were fair, and very fair. Her beauty made me glad. Sisters and brothers, little maid, how many may you be? How many? Seven in all, she said, and wondering looked at me. Why is this guy asking this stupid question? And where are they? I pray you tell. Right? So where are all your sisters and brothers? You're all here alone. He says, she answered, seven are we, seven. And two of us at Conway dwell, and two are gone to sea, and two of us in the churchyard lie, they're dead, my sister and my brother, and in the churchyard cottage I dwell near them with my mother. Wait a minute, he says, you say that two at Conway dwell and two are gone to sea, and yet ye are seven. I pray you tell sweet maid how this can be. Your arithmetic is wrong. Two are dead. You're not seven. You're only five. That's it. He doesn't get it. She doesn't get it. Then did the little maid reply, seven boys and girls are we. Two of us in the churchyard lie beneath the churchyard tree. You run about, my little maid. Your limbs, they are alive. If two are in the churchyard laid, then ye are only five. Simple arithmetic. From seven, take two who are dead, and you got five. And she says, their graves are green. They may be seen, the little maid replied. 12 steps or more from my mother's door, and they are side by side. My stockings there I often knit, my kerchief there I hem, and there upon the ground I sit and sing a song to them. Here's Wordsworth writing in the language of people, two people. Nothing fancy about those lines. I couldn't stand them when I was young. Come on, be a little poetic. And often after sunset, sir, when it is light and fair, I take my little porringer, my bowl of porridge, and eat my supper there. The first that died was Sister Jane. In bed she moaning lay, till God released her of her pain, and then she went away. So in the churchyard she was laid, and when the grass was dry, together round her grave we played, my brother John and I. And when the ground was white with snow and I could run and slide, my brother John was forced to go, and he lies by her side. Ah, he says, how many are you then, said I, if they two are in heaven? Quick was the little maid's reply, oh master, we are seven. They are dead. Those two are dead. Their spirits are in heaven. toward throwing words away, for still the little maid would have her will, and said, nay, we are seven. Now, if we wanted to be not even so superficial, we could talk about this in contemporary terms. I won't do this, about the tremendous chasm there is in the United States right now between 55% of Americans who think Donald Trump is a lying, cheating fraud, and 40% of Americans who think he's the greatest thing ever to hit the presidency. And those groups cannot talk to each other across the chasm because they think differently from each other. It's not just a, you can't just go if you're against Trump and talk to somebody who's for Trump and through logic convince them. Nor vice versa. Somebody who loves Trump can't talk to somebody who says Trump is a liar and hates Trump, and through logic somehow bring them around. There are different ways of thinking. Now what's happening in this poem, poem isn't about Trump or anti-Trump. This is a poem about adults and children. And what Wordsworth is recognizing in this poem, it's astonishing. Children think differently than adults. They live in a different world than adults. Adult reason doesn't work on them. And the way they think doesn't always make sense to grown-ups. And it's an astonishing vision that Wordsworth is having, because I'll tell you what happens to Wordsworth, and we'll see this happening in some of the poems. He gets a little stuck. You know, life is really tough. The last of the poems we're going to read starts out, the world is too much with us, late and soon, getting and spending, we lay waste our powers, little we see in nature that is ours. We're all on our cell phones, we're all going to Walmart, we're all going to the supermarket, we're all, and we get lost. And he will tell us, in these poems we're going to read, we get despondent, we get depressed, we get the feeling alienated. I think he's the great poet of alienation, of being separated from our world and ourselves. It would take another 35 years before a German philosopher named Ludwig Feuerbach would say, oh, there's a word for that, it's called alienation. And after 10 years after him, then another German philosopher named Karl Marx would say, that's the problem. We're alienated. Because we're alienated from, Marx would say, from our labor. Now, what Wordsworth is doing is saying that if we feel alienated, not in this poem, but he will later in this poem, if we feel separated from ourselves and from our values and from how to see a way forward, you know, Dante starts the Divine Comedy by saying it's when life is too much like a pathless wood. I mean, that's from Frost, right? That's from Frost, Tom, isn't it? Birches, it's when life is too much like a pathless wood. Dante starts out in the middle of life's journey, he feels like he's stuck in the woods. Wordsworth feels we're stuck. And one way of dealing with that stuckedness that we have is to return to our childhood, when things actually seem more cheerful and happier and made more sense. So this poem is a recognition that there is a world of childhood that we, with our rationality and our arithmetic and our advanced understanding of death, understand, and children don't understand. Well, I don't know. When people are dead, are they really gone? Does a child really have it wrong? I don't know. I mean, I'm not trying to judge this. Is arithmetic the answer to everything? 7 minus 2 equals 5. And Wordsworth is calling into question this adult world and this adult logic of ours. But most importantly in this poem, he's writing in simple language about the tremendously different world that children live in from the world that adults live in. Children are not just little adults. They live in a different world. So let's look at another poem. I can't say it's a poem, it's a pair of poems. And I put them here, I don't think it's the worst thing to say to all of you who came out to hear somebody talk about Wordsworth. I'm not sure I fully understand either poem. These are the poems I actually would quote to people in a set.
I would call him up on my BlackBerry and say, hey, don't you get it? There's something to learning that has to do with other than taking tests in schools. In fact, this was legislation about taking tests and showing that students are proficient in arithmetic and in reading. Nothing to do with social sciences, nothing to do with wanting to learn and being inquiring, nothing to do with that excitement that, you know, young kids feel when they first discovered that, oh, these books in the library. I lived across from a library in Washington, and I'd see all these kids come in with their parents, low-income families, and kids would have stacks of books like this, taking them out. Oh, I could get all these things and read about all these people. And then they get to school, it's all about tests. So I would read them parts of these poems. I'm backwards, sorry. Okay, expostulation means someone says something and then he replies. And it's a two-person poem. His friend Matthew says, hey, Wordsworth, why are you just lazing about all the time? Why are you sitting on that rock in the sun? Why aren't you reading books? That's how you learn things. That's what professors say. I spent most of my life as a professor, and I believe that's true. Why, William, on that old gray stone, thus for the length of half a day, why, William, sit you thus alone? And you notice there's the echo of the ballad meter, the last line of every stanza is only six syllables. And dream your time away. Where are your books that light bequeathed to beings else forlorn and blind? I mean, we would be lost, and we'd be blind without books. Up, up! And drink the spirit breeze from dead men to their kind. Hey, you know, you gotta go out there and read Homer and Plato, because they understood things, and without them, you will be bereft. You look round on your mother earth as if she for no poor purpose bore you, as if you were her firstborn birth and none had lived before you. You're trying to invent life all over again instead of learning from the wisdom of the ancients and from the old and all those things that can be gotten from books. And as you see, it began with a quotation mark, and here the quotation ends. And then comes the reply of Wordsworth. He says, you know, I was sitting one morning by a lake in the Lake District, one morning thus by Esquade Lake, when life was sweet, I knew not why, to me my good friend Matthew spake, and thus I made reply. Location marks, the eye, it cannot choose but see, we cannot bid the ear be still, our bodies feel where'er they be, against or with our will. Not less I deem that there are powers which of themselves our minds impress, that we can feed this mind of ours in a wise passiveness. Just taking it in. Just seeing. Our eyes can't help but see. Our ears can't help but hear, he says. that we can feed this mind of ours in a wise passiveness. Think you in all this mighty sum of things forever speaking that nothing of itself will come, but we must still be seeking? Then ask not, wherefore here alone, conversing as I may, I sit upon this old gray stone and dream my time away. It's not the kind of poem you want to teach in school. It's not the kind of poem you want to read if you're sitting in the Senate room and deciding what kind of tests you're going to give to people to show that they're really learning and government dollars are used well. If this, no, if we just sit and think and perceive and see as we see, we can learn mighty and important things. That's really pretty profound. Is he right? I don't know. It's a voice we have to listen to. And then he has another poem. Do you know that line about, who are you going to believe? Me or your own lying eyes? You know where it comes from? It comes from a Marx Brothers film. I had to look it up, right? Where Groucho's brother, who's pretending to be Groucho, says to Margaret Dumont, she says, but you just laughed at him. And he says, who are you going to believe? Me or your own eyes? Well, Wordsworth is saying, no, we have to trust, you know, to our own eyes. The eye cannot choose but see. Out of this will come the great philosophy of Ralph Waldo Emerson, probably the greatest thinker in American history, and the guy who impelled his friend Thoreau to go out in the woods. He said, no, we have to rely on ourselves, on what we experience. Why read books when we can read God directly? That's a quote Emerson says in The American Scholar. So that there's a large portion of what we have that says we can trust to ourselves, and that books will be like sophistry that will lead us astray. I'm a teacher. I taught a lot of books, right? And I'm talking now about a poem that was found in a book. I'm not averse to books, but I think he's telling us something we need to hear, which is that we can get lost in books. And if we want to root ourselves, find a firm bottom in rocks and place and say, this is and none else, that's also from Thoreau. If we want to find that place, maybe it's in our direct apperception of the world around us, and not just from books. Okay, so here's the next poem, which is called The Tables Turned. It is a companion poem to the last one. And in this one, he speaks to his friend who had spoken to him, Matthew, in the previous poem. He said, hey, get away, leave those books behind. I'm saying this in the library, right? Up, my friend, and quit your books, or surely you'll grow double, the real you and the book. Self-you, maybe. I don't know what that double means. I'm proposing it. I'm not sure I get it. Up, my friend, and clear your looks. Why all this toil and trouble? The sun, this is a beautiful, beautiful stanza. And if I didn't learn to love Wordsworth, I would have thought, it's a flat poem. But it's about the gorgeousness of the world. The sun above the mountain's head, a freshening luster mellow through all the long green fields has spread his first sweet evening yellow. You know what he's talking about. You've all seen that. A field that we encounter at evening where the sun going down has become golden hued instead of just bright, and everything has the light of gold cast over it. It's a really gorgeous stanza, and it, unlike so many poets, he doesn't call attention to himself. Let me just find where I am in this thing. Books, 'tis a dull. Yeah. Bo- brooks, 'tis a dull and endless strife. Come hear the woodland linnet. How sweet his music on my life. There's more of wisdom in it. Right, and I gloss linnet, and I'll gloss throstle here, so you know what he's talking about. He's talking about listening to birds. And hark how blithe the throstle sings. He too is no mean preacher. Come forth into the light of things. Let nature be your teacher. Guess he is a nature poet. But he speaks to us about the natural world, as many of us believe the natural world to be. We believe following Wordsworth. Before Wordsworth, nature was this thing you wanted to get away from. You want to live in a city. Nature was full of wolves and bandits. And he said, no, no, we can learn something from looking at nature and being in nature. And I'm willing to bet that a large number of you go out in the fall and look at the leaves turning and think, something. Wordsworth is telling us to do that and trust in that. Let nature be your teacher. She has a world of ready wealth, our minds and hearts to bless, spontaneous wisdom, breathed by health, truth, breathed by cheerfulness. So if we go out in nature, nature will teach us things. One impulse from a springtime wood may teach you more of man, of moral evil, and of good than all the sages can. No, we have to ask ourselves, do we believe that's true? That we learn about good and evil from communing with nature, from feeling what's in ourselves, or do we learn from books? That's a real question. I don't think it's easily answered. And he's taking a position here, and he says, and then this next stanza is pretty astonishing. Sweet is the lore which nature brings. Our meddling intellect misshapes the beauteous forms of things we murder to dissect. How do we take things apart? How do we decide what's in the body? We have to kill the thing first, and then we can cut it apart. I mean, you've all had that feeling, right? That's one of the reasons that so many people get turned off from reading poems, right? We have to dissect the poem. You all remember in seventh grade, the smart kid in the front row, said, I got the answer, I know what that poem means. And we feel whatever there was in the poem that spoke to us is gone because we've dissected it. We've taken the living guts out of it so we can take it apart. I believe in taking poems apart. I believe we can learn things. But I think we also have to put them back together. And just as I think living creatures and not just dissecting tables are the way we live in the world. Enough of science and of art. Close up those, whew, I'm in a library here, right? Close up those barren leaves. Come forth and bring with you a heart that watches and receives. This is this wise passiveness he talked about in the last poem. This is the poet who is saying we have to pay attention to the world in which we live. It's pretty amazing. It's a response in the most profound way to the Enlightenment and to the sense that if we only use our reason enough, we can figure everything out. Then we come to, this is from the next edition of Lyrical Ballads. And I bring it here, it doesn't quite fit in. I think it's the most perfect poem written in English. And I'll explain why in a moment. And it seems so simple. This is, you know, the Wordsworth that somehow we're not sure we really want to learn. No pyrotechnics. He says, a slumber did my spirit seal. I had no human fears. She seemed a thing that could not feel the touch of earthly years. No motion has she now, no force. She neither feels nor hears nor sees roll round in earth's diurnal course with rocks and stones and trees. Doesn't seem like much of a poem. Well, let's look at it a little more carefully without totally dissecting it. Let's look at the verb tenses, right? Stanza one is all in the past. Stanza two is all in the present. They're very different worlds, like we had a different world with the child and the grown-up. It's gonna come here too, actually. A slumber did, my did, had, seemed, has, hears, sees, is, rolled. Right? You can all see the tense shifts from past to present. So what is between the past and the present? What's happening in this white space? This is what makes it, to me, such an extraordinary poem. What happens in this white space? Death. His beloved, I've called the Lucy poems, who knows if there was really a Lucy, his beloved has died. She seemed like she lived forever, and now she has no motion. Right? Something amazing happens in this poem, and it doesn't happen in the lines. It happens between the stanzas. I sometimes can't get over how the very center of the poem is not said at all. Okay, let's look at it another way, of seeming against reality. He's sleeping. He's human, but he doesn't have human fears. She seemed, not she was, she seemed something. And then in the second stanza, there's a now, which is completely opposed to the seeming, the reality and the seeming, right? And in between is death, something has happened which he hadn't expected. And I love the ending. He's full of wishfulness. My loved one. I was kind of asleep. I thought she'd go on forever. I didn't worry about anything. And she couldn't feel the years, time passing, which passes for all of us. And then all these extraordinary negatives, right? No motion has she now, no force she neither hears nor sees. No, 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 no. It's not like I thought it was in the first stanza. Amazing poem. I mean, it's eight lines, and it's in this ballad stanza, and it would seem to be a little sing-songy, and I think it's about the most important things we can confront in our existence, which is what we wish and hope for and what the reality is, and how death intrudes whether we want it to or not. I mean, it takes up a lot of really serious stuff. I have some questions. We can come to them in the questions. I'll ask you, and you can tell me. What's the difference between rocks and stones? I don't know. I wrote about it, but I don't know. Roll round in earth's diurnal course with rocks and stones and trees. Oh, only a very stupid person said, well, you needed a word in there to complete the rhythm. This is a really great poet. Why are there rocks and stones? I don't have an answer for you. What's the difference between rocks and stones rolled round in earth's diurnal course with rocks and stones and trees? Well, you all know the answer to that one. Right? Trees are animate and rocks are not. So there's something animate going on even though some things are stopped. No motion has she now, no force she neither hears nor sees. And then, isn't there a contradiction? Which poems, one of the great things about poems, about literature in general, the reason why we need literature and can't subsist only on philosophy, has not only to do with feeling, but the fact that philosophy almost entirely depends on the law of the excluded middle. Something is either A or not A, can't be in between. So he says in the last stanza, no motion has she now, no force. She doesn't move. No force. So how can she be rolled round? Right? Is he telling us something about how life is going on? I mean, you'll tell me. But that's a real question. He starts out, no motion has she now. And then he says, rolled round. In the same four-line short stanza. Okay, we're going to move on. The last poem in Lyrical Ballads of 1798 was a very long poem, long for the time. I mean, he would end up writing the Prelude, which I think is his greatest poem and is 250 pages long. But this poem called Lines Composed, and the whole title is unbelievably long, right? Lines Composed a Few Miles Above Tintern Abbey on Revisiting the Banks of the Wye During a Tour, July 13, 1798. Some of you studied it, you call it Tintern Abbey. Right? And in the poem, he visits a place that was a ruin then and is even more of a ruin now with his sister. And he says, yeah, I visited here 5 years ago and I was different and it was different. And he meditates on time and change and maturity. It's a really great poem, but I'm not including it here because it's written, although another poem will be written in this, it's written in iambic pentameter. It's following along from Shakespeare's dramas and from John Milton's poetry. It's a great intellectual poem. But I want to highlight two sections because I think they admirably set up the next poem, which is one of the most beloved of all English poems, and a little hokey. And yet, these point out how it's not quite as hokey as we think. So, he's talking to his sister here. He says, let me pray. This prayer I make, knowing that nature never did betray the heart that loved her. And this guy is such a good poet. But here he's straining. He's trying to be a Milton, and he's doing a good job of it. It's not like meeting a little girl and doing arithmetic, right? Knowing that nature never did betray the heart that loved her, 'tis her privilege through all the years of this our life to lead from joy to joy, for she can so inform the mind that is within us, so impressed with quietness and beauty, and so feed with lofty thoughts that neither evil tongues, rash judgments, nor the sneers of selfish men, nor greetings where no kindness is. Nancy, I mentioned that when we were talking before. I bet we all live in a world where people say, hi, how you doing? Is everything okay? We don't really want to kill us.
Right? No one to know.
You know, we have to survive in that world. How do we do that? He says, nor all the dreary intercourse of daily life. Life can get boring. I've been writing about Baudelaire. If you signed up for my list, you'll get about Baudelaire. Baudelaire is really into ennui, into boredom. That's a dreary intercourse of daily life. Shall air prevail against us? We have something deep in us that has been socked away, that militates against boredom and people who sneer at us and evil tongues and rash judgments and the sneers of selfish men. And then he'll go on a little later in the poem to say, when thy mind, talking to a sister still, shall be a mansion for all lovely forms. I think he's hearkening back to the Bible there. Thy memory be as a dwelling place, again the Bible, for all sweet sounds and harmonies. Oh then, if solitude or fear or pain or grief should be thy portion, with what healing thoughts of tender joy wilt thou remember? So it's about finding something that is a tender joy that can help us through a life that may have too much loneliness, too much fear, too much pain, too much grief and loss. How do we endure that, says Wordsworth. And so we come to this poem. But I think most of you read this at some point in your schooling. I wander lonely as a cloud. Oh, God, it's all about graphic bills. But there's something in the poem. My colleague at UVM, Dan Fogel, pointed out to me, and really transformed the poem to me, that is really amazing. So he starts out, you know, and I've had this experience. I bring myself to the poem. I have twice in my life had this experience of walking up a mountain and seeing wild daffodils blooming all around me. Once when I was alone, actually with some friends, my wife wasn't with me in Italy, and once when my wife was with me in Portugal. In the mountains, I think it's crocus, maybe dubbed apples, I don't remember. But all of a sudden, the world is alive with flowers. We've all had that experience. Mm. And in this case, it's daffodils. And he's seeing the daffodils growing along the shores of a lake, and he's saying, God, they are beautiful. Yeah, well, it's a little trite. I'm not sure. I think people like it because we can all identify, but did we need a poet to tell us this? I wandered lonely as a cloud that floats on high o'er vales and hills, when all at once I saw a crowd, a host of glorious daffodils, of golden daffodils, beside the lake beneath the trees, fluttering and dancing in the breeze. Continuous as the stars that shine and twinkle on the Milky Way. It's like looking up the Milky Way, except there are more of them, and they're yellow, and they're daffodils, right? They stretched in never-ending line along the margin of a bay. 10,000 saw I at a glance, tossing their heads in sprightly dance. Let me see if I can get it to go the right way. The waves beside them danced, but they outdid the sparkling waves in glee. A poet could not but be gay in such a jocund company. Right? You can't help but be happy when the world is blooming. Pretty good. Not great, but pretty good. I gazed and gazed, but little thought what wealth the show to me had brought. And here's what my friend Dan pointed out to me that just blows your mind. For oft, when on my couch I lie in vacant or in pensive mood, they flash upon the inward eye, which is the bliss of solitude, and then my heart with pleasure fills and dances with the daffodils. We have times in our lives when we lie around depressed, vacant, empty, thinking dire thoughts. And what sustains us but that moment of beauty and joy that we encountered years before? That's what he's telling us. If we read this long poem I've mentioned several times, it's called The Prelude. That's really what the whole poem is about. That some things are laid down for us, in us, says Wordsworth. And what happens is they're laid down in us in our childhood. Wordsworth lived 100 years before Freud. He got everything Freud was going to go after. Not everything, but most of it. That in our childhood, we are shaped. And if there are good things in our childhood, if there are loving things, if there are joyous things, then that is something we can always return to, says Wordsworth. And he says, and if as a child we see that nature is something beautiful and wonderful and exciting or whatever it is, we can always return to nature and be rejuvenated. I don't know. I don't know if he's right. I don't have any other answers. I mean, I don't think we're going to be rejuvenated by reading Plato. Well, I read Plato a year ago and found Socrates amazing. I mean, just wow. I mean, Donald Trump didn't understand Trump. I mean, Socrates basically said, you know, I gotta think about things. I gotta think about myself. I gotta ask questions about everything I encounter. And that is the great attitude of Western culture. And he invented it. So there are good things about reading books. You know, we shouldn't throw them away as he somewhat suggests. But what sustains us in the end is not Socrates. It's I don't know. Eric Erickson says it is the nurturance of our mother's breast, that life will give us sustenance. I don't know. So Wordsworth is attuned to that. And he says, and when you feel bad, when you feel vacant and pensive, when you're lying around your apartment, yes, what will raise you up are those memories like I have of those daffodils I saw when I was a kid, even if they're a little sentimental. Okay, here comes my heart leaps up. when I behold it. It's the part of it is the epigraph to his famous ode intimations of, which I think is a little overrated. It's got about 8 lines in it. It's a very short poem. And I'll say, I like to say outrageous things. I think it has the single most astonishing line anybody ever wrote. A lot of people have written words. He says, my heart leaps up when I behold a rainbow in the sky. So was it when I was a child. Oh, rainbow up there was great when I was a kid. I said, woo, a rainbow. And now I say, woo, a rainbow. I mean, when I see a rainbow, I say to my wife, come to the window, look, there's a rainbow. Or she says to me, I want it to be that way when I grow old and I'm dying. I still want to be thrilled by rainbows, right? So my heart leaps up when I behold a rainbow in the sky. So was it when my life began, so is it now. I am a man, so be it when I shall grow old or let me die. The child is father to the man, and I would wish my days to be linked each to each by natural piety. What? The child is father to the man? Of the man? Wait a minute. Many of you have had children, right? Men and women have children. Children don't have their parents. They don't birth them. I mean, that's such a stunning line. It goes against everything that we think and believe, that our parents raised us. And he's saying, no. My father is the child I once was. That my youth, my early years, are what formed me. And he reverses entirely what we think we know of biology and familial lineage. You know, the father has a child. He says, no, the child is father to the man. That's the line I find so stunning. And just totally counter to anything that we could say or think. The child is father to the man. Now we can think it now, because we live 200 years after, 220 years after Wordsworth said it, but nobody could say it before. Really not. It took Freud, 100 years to say, oh, I was right. I mean, he didn't read Wordsworth, but, he got it. And even today, when we're lost, we think back to childhood. And what it is in our childhood that maybe could sustain us, that could provide us a clue as to the path forward. And that's what I think he's saying here. I mean, he does talk about natural piety and links, and we're linked because we all have this reverence for nature, right? And I could wish my days to be linked to each by natural piety. But what's really amazing in the poem is this sense that the child is father to the man. I'm trying your patience. I'll do one more poem if you'll bear with me. I get these poems all wrong, when I read them. I taught a seminar once on politics and literature, and the central text in the poem in the course turned out to be this sonnet, this next sonnet by Wordsworth. You can all understand. The world is too much with us. The world is too much with us. You can understand what he's talking about. It's a sonnet, right? It's got 14 lines, and it's got an octet and a sestet, except the octet runs a little long, so it's 8.5 lines, not 8 lines, and sestet is not 6 lines, but 5.5 lines. But, good poets have rules, and they can break them. And the opening is so wonderful. it's so much about the world we live in that we can too often be oppressed by, right? The world is, I've already said it to you, the world is too much with us, late and soon, getting and spending. We waste our power, little we see in nature that is ours. And we're cut off from things because we're caught up in, he tells us, in shopping, in making things in factories. It's the evils of modern life, right? That cut us off from the natural world and from ourselves. Little we see in nature that is ours. That's pure Feuerbach, you know? Alienation is when we become alienated from ourselves, not just from nature. But Marx says it too. Mm-hmm. We have given our hearts away a sordid boon. Hey, you know, I wanted to get a Rolex, and so I did this all my life, and now what do I got? And then he says, look, he sees out at night. He says, this sea that bears her bosom to the moon. So, you know, the sea is open. It looks like a bosom, and the moon reflects off it. The winds will be howling at all hours in the morning. There can be a lot of winds, but right now it's calm. And are upgathered like sleeping flowers. For this, for everything, we are out of tune. It moves us not. I thought that was great. When I was a young professor and teaching students, I said, well, you know, that's what it's really all about. That's what the modern world does to us. It wipes us out. It makes us so we're out of touch with the world we live in and with ourselves. And we can't respond authentically, whatever that word means, to the world. And I then, now, dismiss the second half of the poem as being overdone, rhetoric. Great God, I'd rather be a pagan suckled in a creed on war. I mean, I thought that was garbage. You know, added on to an acute assessment. I've turned around. I love the end of this poem. He says, great God, I'd rather be a pagan suckled in a creed outworn. So might I, standing on this pleasant lea, which is a kind of little hilltop, have glimpses that would make me less forlorn, have sight of Proteus rising from the sea, or hear old Triton blow his wreathed horn. I see sea gods. Proteus and Triton are minor sea gods for the great Greeks. Why do I like the poem so much? It's a rhetorical question. I like it so much because I think about the man who wrote it. Here's Wordsworth writing in 1802. He's writing in a devoutly Christian culture, in a culture that has prized what Christ taught the world about. Yeah, he was not religious, but what about compassion and loving others? And he said, we made the wrong choice! We should have been Greeks with all their gods, who I don't believe in for a second, he says. Right? Well, he says, because what we've lost is a sense that nature is animate, that it's alive, that it's going on, that it's filled with spirits. I'd rather be a pagan, he says, than live the life I'm living. Not only buying and selling, but this good middle class, bourgeois, Christian life. Amazing poem. So I'm going to conclude with this, and it's gone on too long. I tried it out, it was 40 minutes, and I've kept you here for 5 minutes. But I think what Wordsworth does, he confronts what I think is the central issue of individual life, which is that life can so often seem hopeless, we can seem lost, can feel a vacancy within us. We can feel unconnected to the world, to other people. One of the reasons people embrace Twitter and Facebook is because they don't feel connected. And then they spend all their lives with a little screen in front of them and they think they're going to be more connected, and I'm not sure if they are. And Wordsworth says, no, that's not the way to be more connected. The way to be more connected is to go back to before we made the wrong choices. To childhood, to nature from which we came, and then which surrounded us when we were young, before we had all those books, to primitive people, be they Greeks or shepherds, as he runs into in lyrical ballads, or little girls, to go back and find out where we made these wrong turns that led to a life, however rich it may be, to have Walmarts and cell phones and voting machines and 24/7 television news. However satisfying we may think that is, we've kind of lost sight of who we are and what we are and what would satisfy us. And Wordsworth says, he's a great sayer for us. Not only have we lost our way, but this is the way back. The way back is to go back in our lives to something earlier and say, where did we go wrong? And I think he is really a great poet. A great poet because he is, and not just because of his words and his ability to use words beautifully, which he does at times, and at times in simple ways that remind us that we all speak to each other in daily life in common language, but also because Wordsworth reminds us in a very, very, I think, important way that that we need to be in touch with ourselves and our world. We need it more than anything, and we have lost our way. And he says there are ways back. And he might not even be right about the ways back, but he's right about the diagnosis of our condition. And for that deep seeingness, he's a great poet, not only because he writes beautiful lines, but because he has vision into who he is and who we are. All his friends, I read, Tom Regal asked me, we were having dinner, and what the best biography of Wordsworth is. And I don't remember the name of the biography I read that told me this. I should. But all of Wordsworth's friends, all of them smarter in some ways than him, knew he was the great man of their time. He could feel his way into life and the future that lay before us. And I think that's what's so astonishing about him. He not only writes well, but he has this vision of who we are and what we confront and maybe how we can deal with it. So thank you, and let's have a few questions, not too many, because you've been very touching.
In preparation for tonight's presentation, I cut out my 7 centuries of verse. Uh-huh. And read what was in there. Only the world is too much with us and the daffodils and so forth. But Lucy, do you have anything to say about Lucy?
No.
Okay, very good.
He wrote 5 Lucy poems,
yes,
which are kind of love poems. We don't know who he was in love with. We don't know who he was in love with. We don't know if there was a real person.
Yeah. Was he more like a child who died?
I don't think so. I think he was a lover. You know, she dwelt beside untrodden ways who talks about loving her. I mean, I think they're love poems. Here's the strange thing. I was writing this the other day. I mean, you'll get it if you signed up for my email. One of the strange things about literature is we can make up fictions and they're more real than the real world. And sometimes they're just fictions of ourselves, right? And we all have selves. Right? You are a person, I'm a person. We all made that up. We just made it. Yes, it consists of all the stories we tell ourselves about ourselves and all the memories we have of who we have been. It's all a fiction. Now, Wallace Stevens, maybe if you invite me down, I'll talk about Wallace Stevens. Wallace Stevens, the great poet of fictions. We make it up. There's a wonderful, wonderful quote in the New York Times today. A Japanese architect won the Pritzker Prize, which is like the Nobel Prize for architects. And he says he loves being an architect because there's nothing there and you can build something. And then afterwards, there's nothing there again. And it was just so, I thought, so astonishing, such a vision of. So I think, I mean, it's a long answer. Nobody knows who Lucy was, and I think the general sense is that, that this was a fiction he made up so he could write about his experience of loss and death. And it was a vehicle for that. So it's hard to say. Other questions? Do you like Wordsworth?
No.
Did I mean, I hope a little bit. I mean, I hated him so much when I was young, right? Did some of you hate him? I couldn't have been alone, right? I mean, you know, I mean, Keats writes these wonderful lines, but I'll take Wordsworth. Yes?
Ode to immortality. Ode to immortality.
Yeah, I know, right? I have trouble with that poem.
Oh.
No, I do, and this is me. I think it's a very great poem, and it has some of the greatest lines ever written in English. I mean, just gorgeous. The hour of splendor in the grass and glory in the flower. The humblest flower that blows often hides thoughts that lie too deep for tears. I mean, it's just a gorgeous poem, but I have a little sense. You don't have to follow me. He had a little notebook, and he said, how can I put these good words together and make this poem? And I think these earlier poems came out from deep within him, that this is how he experienced the world. So I'm not the greatest fan of the intonation sound. Many people who like Wordsworth think it's one of his greatest poems. So I'll leave you with that. I think they're not wrong.
Earlier today, I was reading a poem by Frank O'Hara, The Day Lady Died.
Oh, what a great poem.
What an incredible poem. But a slumber did my spirit heal. The break in that reminds me of the very last line. I stopped breathing.
Yeah. I don't know if everybody's read Frank O'Hara, who is a New York poet, very much affiliated with the abstract expressionists of the 1950s. He's a direct lineal descendant of Wordsworth. He's going to write poems in everyday language. And he's going to write about ordinary events, despite that being the day Lady died. He's going to write about the that appeared in a book called Lunchbox Poems, or Lunch Poems. Poems are wrong when he was eating lunch, right? Or to read while you're eating lunch. So he's writing in the vernacular. He's writing about ordinary things. He's finding
the
transcendent meaning that comes out, that sustains us. In a world that is actually hard. I think he's very related to
Wordsworth. But just making that connection between Wordsworth and O'Hara came to me.
Absolutely.
I just was going to comment that I think a lot of us were introduced to good poetry when we were too young to appreciate it. And it's so much so different to hear it when you're old enough to know what he's talking about, as it were.
Well, I think we change as we read poems. As I think I've suggested a couple of times, some of these poems are different to me now than they were 30 years ago. And I think that's a testimony to the kind of deep structures and the deep communications that go on in certain kinds of words that they can keep speaking to us over a lifetime. I used to have my students memorize poems, partly so that when they grew up, they could return to those poems and find the poems that Whitman says in one of his lines, my words itch at your ear. They could say, now I get it, just like you're saying. But I think there's something else that goes on. And I think children like poems. You know, I watch my grandson with books, and he likes books that rhyme, and kids like books that rhyme. And I think children like the magic of language. And I may be wrong. We all have to have our opponents, but I think school beats poetry out of us. I think that experience, which I remember it greatly, what is the meaning of this line? What is this symbol about? And there's always some kid waving their hands like, I know, and everybody else feels kind of dumb. And you know, I actually think Wordsworth speaks to all of us.
I wonder if perhaps we don't realize how much we keep going throughout our whole life.
Yeah, I think that's right. I think we do keep going. And in the thing I'm going to send out, it's very much on my mind. I quote Eliot. I don't like T.S. Eliot much, but he loved Baudelaire, and he channels Baudelaire in one of his late poems. He says, old men should be explorers here and now. Doesn't matter, we must be moving and further moving. And we always have to keep moving forward. in life. And I think that's true of our relation with poems. Whenever we think we know what the poem is all about, it's over for us. And I'm always surprised by rereading poems. You know, I've taught poems for a lot of years, and sometimes I think I didn't see things, and other times I think I was just plain, totally wrong. I just was blind, right? And it's not like I get the answer now. I now am a little more open. I say, oh, there's more than I thought. And there could be more next year, too. And I think one of the reasons we need poems so much, I'll make a plea for poetry. I don't think we talk to each other all that much. You know, I think we live imprisoned in our own solitude. Eliot also says, each man a prison. I think that's too often the case, that we are encapsulated inside ourselves. And in poems, we find people speaking to us of what we share, the things we have in common, and also speaking to us of things that we don't yet know, because life is always full of new things. And one of the advantages of reading poems over time, over a lifetime, is that those words can say new things to us and bring new richnesses to us, that we can realize when we grow older, oh yeah, there was more to Wordsworth than I thought when I was a kid. But I kind of think that kids get it. I'm with Wordsworth on that. I think they get a lot more than we think they get. I'm not always sure I did that when I was a teacher. I sometimes maybe saw my students short a little bit. Oh, I know a lot, I'm a teacher. I went to college and university and got a PhD. But kids know a lot. And I think they know a lot about poems. You know, we may know different things. So how many of you read poems? Most of you, great. Some of you don't. It's okay. When you read poems, what do you use to help you get through poems, come to terms with them? I always wonder about myself, you know, what it is that gets me through poems. There's some poems, let me give, there's a poet named Paul Celan, who some of you may have read, who's wrote in German. He wrote poems that hover on the edge of being understood, and at first I didn't understand them, and then I did. I thought, oh great, I get Celan, I know what he's all about, and 10 years later I picked up Celan and I didn't understand a single word. He slipped back into indecipherability. So it's really hard. I mean, how do you manage to have a conversation with a poem when you're not always sure where the poet is going or what he's talking about? You're going to say something.
I take one line.
Yeah.
And it's in my head. I read the whole poem, but I take one line out of one phrase, and I think on it all day, and the poem stays with me. And toward the middle of the day, my whole perspective on the day has changed.
Yeah.
That's how I interact.
It's a very good way to read poems. I'm not sure that's how I read poems. Letter Nabokov in a wonderful novel called Pale Fire, which is a commentary on a poem that's unfinished. It's supposed to be 1,000 lines, it's only 999 lines. Says, you know, if one line scans right, then the whole universe is in order. If you can get one line. I do the same with poets. I think if I can understand one poem, I can understand many of the rest. But I'm not sure that's true. I don't know. It's a struggle. You know, as I hope I've made clear, I've wrestled with Wordsworth all my life, and I really love him. I love him more than almost anyone. And I'm going to say one more thing. There's a very fine book about a German poet named Rainer Maria Rilke by a philosopher who translated him, because he thought all the translations were kind of cruddy, named William H. Gass. And he says in the introduction, as I recall, he says, you know, I know Rilke better than I know any other human being. I've lived with him all my life. I've lived with his words and what he says at his most intimate feelings. I think that bears thinking about. You know, I think there are people I know very well, like my wife who's sitting here. and who I love very much. But I think there are poets who I know better than I know almost anybody else. They've opened themselves up to me, and I've thought about them, and I've internalized them, and I've had arguments with them and discussions with them. And I think that's a very good thing in a world in which we're often a little short of close relationships.
So I was just going to say, Adam has been waiting patiently in the very back to ask a question.
Oh, pardon me, Adam.
No problem. Sorry I was late, and you may have covered this, but this is another way into poetry. My question is, Wordsworth and music, and I'm talking about music as silence as well as music as left of nature. What was his relationship to music? I'm fascinated by this deep understanding of Wordsworth, and I apologize, I missed quite a bit.
That I know of, he didn't have that much of a relationship to music. But I think that the question you raised is a really important one. I think music...
The music of language, almost.
...underlies all poetry. William Carlos Williams was asked by Mike Wallace, before Mike Wallace was famous. Mike Wallace read him a poem that he'd written about a Dungeness crab and some mushrooms and this and that. He says, it sounds like a fashionable grocery list. And William said, it is. William's put this interview in his long poem, Patterson. He said, it is a fashionable grocery list. So Wallace said, what makes it a poem? And he says, well, a poem is always something more. And the more is the music. He said, a poem is words, this is Williams, a poem is words rhythmically organized. And I think great poets have a sense of that music of words. Yeats was tone deaf. He couldn't hear tones, he couldn't hear music. He was the greatest musical worker of words in the 20th century. So there's a rhythm to words, so you can say something, but you can also say something that's going on elsewhere. So that, I mean, on that point, you're completely right. I would say, it's terrible for somebody who loves poetry to say, I think music is the greatest of all arts. I think music doesn't have to figure anything. It just shows us structure and it moves us. And it, I mean, I'm just in awe of music. For a lot of poets, music is immensely, immensely important, but I don't think it was for Wordsworth. You know, I think there are poets who are great musicians themselves, or poets like Whitman who went to the opera all the time, every chance he could get. Who would think that Walt Whitman is always chanting out, you know, I sound my barbaric, yeah, over the streets of the world. Who would think he goes to opera? He loved the opera. So, but I think what you pointed towards is really the central thing about poetry. Poetry is opposed to prose, whatever prose is. And I'm not sure it's a great dividing line. Poetry is when there is a kind of music, a rhythm. I read a wonderful book about the music of poetry. It's not only, it's about short sounds and long sounds and rising sounds and falling sounds and all of those combined together so that we can hear sound patterns. That's what's so amazing, you know, for those of you who listen to music. We can hear it all, even if we can't read music. And we can read music, we can still hear it all. And I think that's true in poems too. So that, I think you're very, very right in saying that.
So thank you so much.
You're welcome.
And fill out the response forms.
Let me just say, you've been very patient. I went on too long, and you are so nice. And I love coming down here. So, thank you.
Yes.
Thank you.